Greetings. Greetings, brother, and thank you for a very interesting question. Is there really an Antichrist? And how can you think you know who he is when people have claimed to know before? That is a great question, brother, and like most good questions, it sounds simple, but needs a complicated, mature answer. I'd like to address the logic of your final point first. When people have claimed to know before. I believe there is a logical flaw, brother, in the assumption behind that statement. The assumption is that if people in the past have been wrong, can anyone ever be right? It's just going to take a moment to explain it. There is a difference between knowledge and assumption. Knowledge is based on a reasoned, and therefore reasonable, logical process of deduction and proof. Assumption is trusting or believing a fact or statement without performing critical verification. Colloquially, assuming is to accept something as true without knowing or being able to prove it is true, and failing to know the difference between fact and assumption gets people in trouble. For example, many people have heard Bible stories, but many people do not make the time to read the Bible to memorize details. And they may have their reasons, or excuses, which version do I memorize, for example. But that failure to study is a major contributor to their confusion and ultimate shame. 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show yourself approved unto God. This is a scriptural directive to study. Some translate the approval clause as, and receive his approval. Present yourself to God as an approved worker, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed. Failure to study will result in being ashamed. You may just shame yourself, but you may also shame others. And that is a fearsome shame indeed if you cause others to slip in the faith. In Luke 17:1, Jesus said to his disciples, "It is inevitable that stumbling blocks will come, but woe to the one through whom they come. It would be better for him to have a millstone hung around his neck and to be thrown into the sea than to cause one of these little ones to stumble." There is a large responsibility on those that teach and preach. Paul even addresses it in how he behaved himself. Read 1 Corinthians 8 for a full context. It has to do with liberty based on faith and knowledge. 1 Corinthians 8:13, "Therefore, if food brings down my brother, I shall never eat flesh, lest I cause my brother to sin." Self-denial is better and preferred to insistence to exercise your liberty for a brother's sake. Okay, getting back to the main thread. Rightly dividing the word of truth. You need to study to rightly divide the word of truth. That implies if you do not study, you will wrongly divide the word of truth. I think that is the root and seed of nearly every doctrinal disagreement in the body of Christ. But as Paul said in 1 Corinthians 7:12, "I say this, not the Lord." Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that doesn't need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So when prior generations or any other person claims, for example, "Ronald Wilson Reagan is the Antichrist because his three names have six letters each, making 666. Or "Gorbachev is the Antichrist because he looks like he has a head wound." It is best to recognize the lack of study or rational cogitation and disregard the rest of their claim. But that does not mean others cannot study more thoroughly and arrive at a correct answer. The process to be more correct and more confident in your knowledge is a journey in itself. I often shock someone when, on certain topics, I will state, "I know," and "I know that I know." That is not saying, "I know everything about everything," but that seems to be what they hear. And I think it runs afoul of some false humility which must demur and pretend to not know. If I know 3 times 5 is 15, I should be able to state it with confidence and certainty, and prove it. But we must always keep in mind to speak the truth in love, and not be an ass in our dogmatism. Let's get back to your question. Is there really an Antichrist? If you search for the term Antichrist, you will find it in 4 New Testament verses. 1 John 2:18, "Little children, it is the last hour, and as you heard that Antichrist comes, even now has there arisen many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last hour." In this verse alone, the term is used twice, once in plural form. In this case, it refers to specific individual human beings and not to a system or group. 1 John 2:22, "Who is a liar but he that denies that Jesus is the Christ?" This same is Antichrist, who denies the Father and the Son. Some translations do not include the definite article "the." This makes the term more of an adjective, but the Greek does include the article "ho antichristos," so the "thee" is there. And if this were the only verse mentioning the Antichrist, it would be a problem. Thankfully, it is not, and by study and comparison, I believe a holistic, coherent understanding is available. Moving on to verse 3. 1 John 4:3, "And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming and is already in the world at this time." This verse does not speak of an individual. It speaks of the spirit of the Antichrist, but could mean an attitude, except it begins with "every spirit confess," which implies this is an entity capable of agency and action, and not just an attitude. And verse 4 that uses the term Antichrist. 2 John 1:7, "For many deceivers are gone forth into the world, even they that confess not that Jesus Christ comes in the flesh. This is the deceiver and the Antichrist." Note, this begins by stating deceivers, in fact, many deceivers, which is plural, more than one. So this establishes a group of deceivers. It continues with "even they," and this identifies a subgroup within the deceivers. That implies 2 things of importance to me. Some deceivers will not address the issue that Jesus is come in the flesh. But they are deceivers all the same, and Jesus said, "Let no one deceive you." Second, it does not say what is confessed about Jesus. But I have a thorough video that I think addresses the issue. Letter to a Muslim Brother, number 80. Does Romans 10:9 contradict John 3:16? So, there are 4 verses in the New Testament that use the term Antichrist. Even looking at the 4 New Testament verses does not give the full picture, so a thorough study requires more searching to hope to find the truth. Your study will uncover mention of the man of sin and the son of perdition and other descriptive names. It is in these descriptions that I find a specific Antichrist begins to be more clearly identified as one particular individual. Is there really an Antichrist, And how can you think you know who he is? As I said, a great question. How can any of us know with absolute certainty that our interpretation of prophecy is perfectly correct? In some cases we can, but in some cases we simply cannot. But we increase our chance of being correct with thorough and accurate study and using a rational approach akin to the scientific method. You must strive to find and then incorporate all the references. You must strive to understand the detail in the prophecy or description. Any proposed or imagined fulfillment must fulfill all the elements of the prophecy. And the explanation of fulfillment should be as simple and relaxed as possible. A strained or tortured meaning to make a fulfillment fit is generally a red flag of error. We see this failure in every example of Islam claiming a Bible verse to justify Muhammad. For example, when Islam claims Muhammad fulfills Deuteronomy 18:18, they torture the word brother. Brethren means the 12 tribes. But Islam claims it means Ishmael, the half-brother of Isaac. Red flag. Islam tortures Isaiah 29:12, which it claims Muhammad is the unlearned man who cannot read the sealed book. But Islam ignores the detail the book is given by men and not an angel. Red flag. When Deedat tries to prove Muhammad is the comforter, Deedat tortures and changes the word spirit into prophet. Red flag. In answering your question, I do not claim absolute certainty knowing who the Antichrist is as a person. However, my desire is to use an approach which will not lead me down a cul-de-sac of error and confusion. Hopefully, it is more based on elimination and verifiable detail than on assumption. Elimination is the useful process by which wrong answers are more easily discarded. For example, when a prophecy has 3 or 4 or 10 details, failure to meet a detail is an immediate disqualifier. But when people have an agenda, they look for 1 point to match, maybe 2, and then ignore the 3 that do not. This is an open door to deception by Satan, and worse, the strong delusion that is coming. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.